Hello everybody, welcome back, and first of all wish you a very very happy new year. So today we have a very interesting topic called decoding a term sheet. Okay, now first of all you need to understand what exactly is a term sheet. A term sheet is a non-binding document. Okay, it is a non-binding document that is basically executed between, let's say, a startup and a set of investors. Okay, so why is this a non-binding document? Because it's an initial principle document. It's just like a discussion paper that, okay, we have discussed a couple of things and just need to jot down those things, basis which we will discuss further. Once basis those discussions, when we reach to a particular conclusion, is when a binding document comes across. So a term sheet is the first step towards a very serious set of discussion between an investor and a startup, which over a period of further clarification ends up into a binding document, which we call it as shareholders agreement. Okay, so that is the purpose of a term sheet. Now there are, it basically includes the kind of so when you discuss around, so how does a funding will look like, so broad parameters of the funding round it discusses about. Okay, like for example, how much funds that you are planning to raise. Okay, whether that fund needs to be in a single shot, which we call it as bullet payment, yeah, that fund has needs to be in tranches, two tranches, three tranches. Agar wo fund tranche mein hai, so what are the milestone basis which that tranche would be actually released? Okay, valuation of the company. Now when we say valuation, there are two sets of valuation. One is called as pre-money valuation, second is called as post-money valuation. Okay, so pre-money valuation is the valuation of the company before the fund round started, and post money valuation is after the funding has come into the company, what is the current valuation of the company. Okay, well, cap table means shareholding pattern of the company. Okay, whosoever has what stake in the company. When we say stake, means equity holding in the company. Okay, now this is a very interesting thing. I'll give a very simple example. Now a board seat conversation is extremely important. Okay, so imagine a situation where you have two founders in the company, and another investor by virtue of investing in the company becomes a board member. Okay, so there are three people who are in the board. So when you take any decisions, you have to go through a board. Any strategic discussions, you have to go through a board. So if it is a 2:1 ratio in this case, so there are two founders who are board members and a single investor, you're still shielded, because if you want to take certain decisions, you can take, because by virtue of the majority, I'm assuming when the founders are in unity, you can take that. Okay, but for example, if the board is constituted in such a way where there are two founders and then there are two investors who have also taken the board seat, and then you have one independent director. So let's say there are five board members. Now what will happen is, there are times when investor invest with the idea of getting quick bucks, okay, or what is the return. So there might be certain discussions which the founders may not have in alignment with the investors. Now technically a founder will have a slightly higher foresight with respect to the company, because he is running the business, it is his baby, right? But investor will think from the point that he needs a better return. So there are times when you have to take some tough decisions. Okay, now suppose such decisions happen and you have this constitution where there are five board members with two as founders, two as the representatives of investor, and one independent. Now in this case, there could be a possibility that an investor and an independent director ke board representative may overseat the founder, and in that case you may not be able to take that strategic decisions as a founder, which is a classic case. So therefore, one of the very important thing is that you need to know is how many board seats are you giving across, where it's a simple thumb rule that it is always better that founders have the majority in board seats, so that there is no hindrance in a day-to-day operations of the work. Now, these three are very important clauses with respect to the investors. Okay. Right of first refusal is, let's say I am investing in your company. Okay. Now, eventually you grow and then you come across and then you take another round of investments. So, because I was the first person to invest in your company, I had to take a risk. I should be given an upper hand wherein when you, if you come for the next round, you should first ask me whether you want to increase your stake or not. Okay. So that is the right of first refusal. If you should first ask me, if I say no, then you can go and ask others. Okay. So that is the right of first refusal. Second is anti-dilution. Anti-dilution is suppose if by virtue of the fact that you are selling the company. Okay. So let's say you had taken a round. At some valuation, let's say you had taken a round at, I'm just giving an example hypothetically, let's say you had taken some 5 crore rupees and in your first round and at a valuation of 25 crores. Okay, now you worked along, but because market did not supported you and stuff didn't happen, so the growth was not as per what you had projected. Okay, and now you are in dearth need of capital, there is a business crunch and all of these things, so you need to take another round of investors just to survive. So suppose now you are trying to survive and here the next round somebody is saying that the best we can give you is a 20 crore valuation. Okay. So now the initial set of investors who had invested at a higher valuation, they need to be protected. Okay. So this is called an anti-dilution. So they need to be protected. So therefore, in this case, what can happen is that if you're reducing the valuation of the company, the subsequent investor who had invested at a higher valuation should be compensated in the form of more number of equities. So this is a protection to the investors who are investing early through anti-dilution. Preemptive is again simple, that what happens is that whenever you invest, there are new shares that are being included in the company. Okay. So preemptive mein kya hoga ki, assume kariye there are 100 shares in the company. I'm just giving an example, ballpark. Suppose if there are 100 shares in the company and you have taken 5% in the company, so you have 5 shares now. Theek hai, ab naya round raise hoga, to basically kya hota hai, there are new set of new equity, further new shares are introduced into the market. So therefore ab wo 100 ka let's say 120 ho gaya. Theek hai, but your stake right now is 5, you have right now only 5 shares, so 5 divided by 120, your percentage would be reduced by 5%, reduced from 5%, because initially you were holding 5 shares when the overall shares were 100. Okay, so that was 5%, but abhi 5 mein 120, kyunki 20 aapne naye shares introduce kar diye, would be less than 5%. So you should have the right to match up only some, you should have the right to buy certain amount of shares so that your stake in the company still remains 5%. So let's say wo 2-4 share aapko khareedna hai taki aapka stake 5% maintained rahe. Theek hai, to ye aapko jo hai, you have that preemptive right to make sure that your shareholding remains settled even if you do not want to increase that stake. See, that is again a protective right for the investor. Theek hai, so these are the investor clauses that comes into play. Theek hai, there are various other interesting clauses that comes into play. Duration of the stay, okay, for the investor. For example, after 3 years or after 5 years, if the investor will ensure that the money, whatever he's investing, he will not revoke it up till 3 years or 5 years. And after 3 years or 5 years, suppose he does not pay, then there is something in terms of repayment, whether it is through founders or selling the company, stuff like that. Okay. Now, liquidation preference is an extremely important clause. Okay. It is basically the right when the company is actually, suppose, has gone for a FUT and it is going towards liquidation. So when the company is getting liquidated, the liquidation preference specifies the priority in which the money will be distributed among the sets of investors and at what magnitude. Okay. So for example, agar maine, main ek example batata hu, let's say I have invested 50 lakhs in a company, theek hai? And I said at 50 lakhs, I am putting a clause at the agreement that I need 2x liquidation preference, theek hai? And with me being the first priority. Now what will happen is, suppose the company has gone for a FUT and it is getting liquidated, and there are, along with me, there are other set of investors. और पता चला कि ये कंपनी में जो है ओवरऑल लिक्विडेट होने के बाद 2 crore rupees is the proceeds that is coming in. Now what will happen is, because I have a 2x right in liquidation, so maine initially invest kiye the 50 lakhs, so 50 into 2 I will get 1 crore, and that too first, and the remaining 1 crore that is left, 1 crore which is left with others will be distributed amongst all. Now technically, if suppose there are many creditors, it would be wrong on the other creditors as well, who have equally were at the part of the risk. So liquidation preference is also extremely important in terms of protection for founders, in terms of protection for other set of investors and all of that. Okay. So that is extremely important. Founder vesting is extremely important. That's again a very interesting clause. It means, see what happens is, at this stage in time, investors basically invest in the founders, if you are early stage. Okay. More than the idea, more than anything, it is actually the founder. If the founder is gone, it's imagine that the company would actually have gone for a fund. So the founder needs to stay with the company for a longer period of time, 3 years, 5 years, whatever it is. So you have to restrict him from getting out of that. So founder vesting is that clause where it says that the founder has to be there with the company for, let's say, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years. If suppose he exits before than that, then he has to repay the investor with whatever amount that he invested, with some percentage of interest, backdated, stuff like that, to make sure that he does not get out of the system. So like that, there are various other clauses, various interesting clauses. So if I have to wrap it up, broad 5-6 clauses that you need to see when it comes to a term sheet is, what is the valuation of the company? What is the fund round that you need to raise? In what kind of a tranches? Then protective clauses for investors, as well as startups in terms of anti-dilution, preemptive rights. Then most importantly, preemptive rights. So like that, there are various other important clauses that comes into the term sheet. Now, once you mutually discuss and agree on most of these points, that means you are now clear that, okay, this is how the transaction will look like. Once you have broadly agreed on this basis, this non-binding document, which is called as term sheet, then you draw a something called as a binding contract, which we call it as SSHA, shareholder agreement, where then it is on the stamp paper and it is a proper agreement where all these clauses, which is mutually agreed upon, is redrafted and put it across and is then being signed. So then that shareholder agreement becomes the principal document. Now, eventually, if you raise another round of investment, so whatever shareholder agreement that you will actually do at the subsequent round will supersede this shareholder agreement. So it keeps on working like that in a series way. Hope you enjoyed this video, and hope this helps. Thank you very much and have a great day.